The overarching idea of this show is to celebrate and recognize the rich tradition of African-American music, to examine the footprints of those musical giants who have illuminated our pathway to new artistic expressions. Welcome to this edition of Black Music Footprints, a jazz experience. Hello, hello, hello. Again, my name is Mondre Moffitt. Jazz at last is jazz. That's what some of the musicians will be saying about this particular episode that I'm producing today. On today's show, I'd like to spotlight the young lions of jazz. The young lions of jazz. Now, it was a movement in the 1980s, and so I need to kind of set the context for this episode that I would like to share with you. This is the 1980s, coming out of the jazz fusion of the 1970s, we had some young musicians who wanted to trace their lineage back to the jazz masters such as Charlie Parker, Thelonious Monk, Dizzy Gillespie, and the bebop era, and even the hard bop era. These were musicians who were graduates and got their training in the pillars of jazz institutions like Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers, Lionel Hampton's Big Band, the Duke Ellington Orchestra, vocalist Betty Carter. These were young musicians in the 1980s, in their late teens, early 20s, who had somewhat of a problem with this jazz fusion, this non-acoustic jazz music, and calling it jazz. They had an issue with it. And so they wanted to come out and make a statement. And they were considered the young musicians with the brightest hope for jazz music. As you recall, in some of my previous episodes, I talked about the death of John Coltrane in the 1960s caused a big stir in the 1970s in terms of the direction of jazz. And so we stumble upon jazz fusion. And no shade on jazz fusion, because I really appreciate some of the subgenres that emerged, such as jazz soul and jazz funk, and the emergence of some outstanding work from Grover Washington Jr. and the likes. But here we are in the 1980s, and this resurgence of acoustic jazz came about and was led by none other than Wynton Marsalis. He led this movement. A product of New Orleans, a product of the Art Blakey Jazz Messengers. And then there were a host of younger musicians that came behind him and played alongside him with this movement. Neo bebop is what some people called it, this renaissance of jazz music, and I am delighted to share this information with you today. Here's a sample of what this acoustic music sounds like. Check it out. This is maybe his second record in the 1980s. He recorded maybe 10 albums in the 1980s. His first record, Begin That Movement, it was self-entitled, Wynton Marsalis. But this is entitled Black Codes from the Underground. You get a sense of this also social consciousness that was really strong in the 1960s. This is Black Codes of the Underground. Thank you. Yes, we had to get to that swing section. I let you hear this great snippet of it. This was a very important record, probably one of Wynton Marsalis' most important records in terms of his identity. And I'm very happy and proud to say that my kid brother is the bassist on this record, Charnette Moffett. He was only 17 years old at the time, but all of these young lions of jazz, Kenny Kirkland on piano, 24, 25 years old, Jeff Tane Watts, you know, classmates at Berklee School of Music, who else was it? And Branford Marsalis. And speaking of Branford Marsalis, another great young line of jazz from New Orleans, come up in that particular culture. Now, here is a piece that he did. This is The Ruby and the Pearl. And Branford here is playing soprano saxophone. Unlike the soprano saxophone you may have heard during the jazz fusion era, but a beautiful, authentic soprano saxophone. Let's check a snippet of his sound. Yes, a very beautiful soprano sax. Acoustic instruments, a return to the ensemble playing, as we heard with the Wynton Marsalis piece, group ensemble playing. And these musicians, they're brothers, of course. Branford Marsalis happens to be the older brother by 14 months. Wynton Marsalis, multiple Grammy winner in both jazz and classical, I think 9 Grammys to date. The first musician ever to win Grammys in classical music and jazz, and he did that in the same year. And I remember that historic day when they played at the Grammys. He played classical music, one of the Haydn trumpet concertos, which is known to be very difficult for trumpeters to play. Played it flawless, and then he went and with his jazz group on the Grammys. My brother playing bass again, and did a piece from Black Coast, the one we just heard. So he is still very vibrant on the music scene today. Now, Branford, his brother, is really a musician's musician. Of course, we will hear a little bit more from Branford. He released 7 albums in the 1980s as well as a leader, and a multi Grammy winner. His work you can hear recently on Ma Rainey. He did the music for the recent release of Ma Rainey. These young lions of jazz are still very relevant today and leading the way in this jazz music. Okay, now, another New Orleans-born musician. Young lion of jazz, again, a graduate of the Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers, similar to Wynton and Branford. Now, a gentleman by the name of Terrence Blanchard. You may know of his work from all of the film scores, say in the last decade, for Spike Lee. I mean, he started with Mo Better Blues, a brilliant composer. He, you know, I think the Met is getting ready this season to do one of his operas. So these are very, very fine, talented musicians out front promoting jazz music, as well as being well-rounded in the entire arts aesthetic. So check out Terrence Blanchard coming from those pillars of the jazz legacy. Here's a piece from his suite. The name of it is the Malcolm X Suite. This is entitled Malcolm's Theme. Again, social consciousness. Thank you. trumpeter Terrence Blanchard with his partner in crime, Donald Harrison, which I'll talk about in a minute, that has made significant contributions as one of the lines of this jazz renaissance. Terrence Blanchard has written over 50 films, multi-Grammy winner, more than 5 Grammys, artistic director of the Thelonious Monk Institute Art in Los Angeles, just a really, really busy, busy musician, composer, producer on the scene. You know, the New York Times had come out with an article about the Young Lions of Jazz in the 1980s that really kind of sparked the interest and the discussion of these young musicians who were dedicated and committed to maintaining the legacy and the lineage of jazz. Much of my program is about that. We are to celebrate the rich performance traditions of African-American music and illuminate those musical giants that we're speaking of that lay down the footprint and the pathway to creativity, development, and new artistic expression. So it is really indeed a pleasure to bring this music to you. Now, here's another New Orleans-born musician. His name is Donald Harrison. Now, Donald Harrison, I see him as the bridge to bebop and hip-hop because he, living in Brooklyn and Bedford-Stuyvesant and the Clinton Hill area, he became a mentor to guess who? Biggie Small. And Biggie Small's freestyle, I am told, there was very much influenced by Donald Harrison. Donald Harrison leaving the New York clubs in Manhattan, coming home and running to Biggie Small on a nightly basis and sharing with Biggie all of the nuances of bebop. And it was a great influence because he learned the rhythms of Max Roach and some of the other bebop musicians during that time. And he credited Donald Harrison, in fact, with being a great musical influence.
Finer qualities of a bebop drum solo. It's incredible.
I'd rather make a buck, drive a fat ass truck, grab the 9-2 clips and run them up. Yes, flex after 2 or 3 bexes, I wreck. What the you expected? A fly guy? Well, I'm a high guy. From bed, stop putting the swelling on your eye. Your nose even, when they choke me, you stop breathing. But police come, I'm leaving. Peace and love. Here we go.
Don't go anywhere. On the other side of the break, we will discuss Mr. Donald Harrison.
The music department at Simmons College now offers a gospel track for its music performance degree. Our Department of Music exists to develop musical knowledge and skill. Students become beneficiaries of program features and faculty that distinguish music as both an academic and artistic discipline. Program options include brass and woodwind instruments, as well as guitar, bass, strings, piano, percussion, and voice. Your gifts will be encouraged and developed by a staff of experienced performing musicians and by the warm support of your peers. You will have frequent opportunities to perform, including vocal ensemble, gospel choir, jazz ensemble, marching band, and other ensembles, both on and off campus. Your music program can go no higher than those who lead it. Now is your time to build a strong music ministry from within. Help support passion already in your community. Help develop gifts already in your congregation. You might have the next James Cleveland in your church and don't know it. The heritage of artistic dignity found at historic black colleges and universities. The tradition of black excellence in gospel music. The calling to use your gift to turn hearts. Your journey toward obtaining a bachelor's degree in music starts now. Simmons College of Kentucky. Apply today. Become a part of the legacy.
Okay, we're back. We are absolutely back here at SSC Live TV, Black Music Footprints, a jazz experience. Once again, my name is Mondre Moffitt, and I am delighted that you decided to muse for a moment with Moffitt. I was talking about Donald Harrison, and Donald Harrison is the bridge, really a bridge to the freestyle of bebop or hip-hop in relationship to bebop. He's coming from out of the masterful schools of Art Blakey and some of the Lionel Hampton and some of the other bands, and sharing that information with some of the leading hip-hop artists of the 1990s, one being Biggie Smalls. And we really recognize and know how masterful of a freestyle musician that he was. It's almost like being a scatting in the jazz culture. That's kind of similar to what that is. And having taught school myself in Brooklyn around some of these wonderful creative rap freestyle musicians, I have been firsthand knowledge to this type of expression and storytelling. Okay, let's check out Donald Harrison. Here's a piece that he wrote entitled New Hope. Donald Harrison, 7 records as a lead in the 1980s, very prolific. New Hope. Donald Harrison, what a great groove. And can't you hear a Biggie Smalls rapping on top of that beat? Started off with just the drums. I can only imagine what that collaboration would have been like had Biggie Smalls lived a very fruitful life throughout the 90s. Now, again, the acoustic sound of the piano, acoustic bass, and drums. None of the fusion type of instruments, synthesizers, if you take note. And another thing that's interesting is that I've introduced to you 4 musicians, all from New Orleans, these 4 musicians, all are graduates of the Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. And that's a whole nother show of the great Art Blakey. And I would love to share some of the Art Blakey stories that I have. And you know, if you know anything about me, I like fun facts, and Art Blakey was notorious for giving musicians nicknames. And I talked about the names like Duke and Account and Lady Day and all of the nicknames. Well, all of these musicians had nicknames, and it was characteristic of what Art determined was their personality. I know Winter's nickname was Skane, for example. There's a story behind that, and Branford's nickname was Book. There's a story behind that. And Don Harrison's nickname is Duck. And so these musicians answer by these names. But it's a very cultural, black cultural aesthetic, if you will. I think I just said something that you would find within this community. So let's continue. What's up next? Here is a musician. So we're talking about New Orleans, and it's no secret the birthplace of jazz, these four musicians. It was a renaissance in the 1980s. But if you can remember, you had King Oliver and King Bolden and Louis Armstrong and a host of great musicians come out of New Orleans. So it's not any big surprise that this whole idea of the 1980s, a resurgence led by New Orleans musicians. But here's a musician that was also one of those lines of jazz, young lines of jazz, an alumni of the Duke Ellington Orchestra, and he's from the Motown city of Detroit. And a musician's musician, probably the most important musician since the 1980s, the most influential saxophone player since the 1980s. The real Kenny G is what we call him. The real Kenny G. His name is Kenny Garrett. Here's Kenny playing a jazz standard entitled, Have You Met Miss Jones? Yes, sir. Mr. Kenny Garrett recorded maybe six albums as a leader in the 1980s. From Detroit, later played with Miles Davis. Miles Davis' last saxophone player. Moving on to the piano players. His alto saxophonist, by the way, of Kenny Garrett. And also Donald Harrison, if I didn't mention, his principal instrument also is alto saxophone. But now I'd like to move on to another lions of jazz, another young lion of jazz by the name of Mulgrew Miller. Grew up in the church in Memphis, from Memphis, playing music in the church, come out, and so you know he's really soulful. And went to New York, and again, one of the pillars of jazz. The Duke Ellington Orchestra, became a member of the Duke Ellington Orchestra, as well as the Art Blakey Orchestra. So he had a lot of masterful teaching among those two institutions. And Mulgrew, here's a recording of Mulgrew playing a John Coltrane composition. You know, this is a resurgence or renaissance to tracing your music back to the masters like John Coltrane. So never, you know, keep that in mind. Here's Giant Steps, solo piano, Mr. Mulgrew Miller. Recording of a pianist in the 1980s playing solo piano. Haven't heard that really since Stride Piano with James B. Johnson and Fats Waller and those guys. And Mulgrew had reminded you of these masters with playing such reharmonization of a great piece, difficult piece, as Giant Steps. And along those same lines, we had another pianist that did similar, but with Thelonious Monk music. His name is Marcus Roberts. Probably at this recording, during the 80s, maybe 24 years old. He did not graduate from the R. Blakey School, but he was one of the pianists that Winton brought into his organization, and he comes out of Winton Marcellus' group. This is Thelonious Monk's Blue Monk. I'll play a little snippet of Marcus Roberts, who had been, he was blind since age 5. He goes on to improvise. You see, this is, you can see just from these recordings of these young musicians, there's a large body of work that happened in the 1980s that we can certainly celebrate. Play a piece by a young, fabulous trumpeter who died way too young a few years ago. His name is Roy Hargrove, and this piece is entitled Strasbourg. Session, just a glimpse into the window of these young jazz masters. But now it's time to play the name game. The way we play this game is, what are the first words that come to your mind to describe the name I'll call out to you? Okay? The first name, the first phrase, young lions of jazz. What would you say? I would say the brightest hope for jazz. The brightest hope. Here's another one. Art Blakey. I mentioned his name a few times, and my immediate response would be a jazz messenger. And the final one, the name of this show, Black Music Footprints. Black Music Footprints. And the answer is a jazz experience. Again, I'd like to thank you for musing a moment with with me, and right here on SSC Live TV. My name is Mondre Moffitt. Thank you very much.